I'm Timothy West, and this is my wife, Prunella Scales.
We're celebrating our golden wedding this year.
Yeah, 50 years. Feels more like 14.
I know.
We might be known as actors.
Basil?
But when we're not treading the boards, it's all hands on deck. Cast off, please.
Aye, sir. We're canal nuts, and we've been pottering around on them nearly all our married life.
With our two boys, Joe and Sam, we've had some of our best times on the canals.
Whenever we get a break, we dash off to our boat.
But we're both getting on a bit now.
I'm going to need some help.
And since we're celebrating 50 years of wedded bliss,
we are determined to make the most of what we love, whilst we still can.
Prue has a slight condition. It's very mild, but it does mean she has difficulty remembering things.
Oh, my darling, I'm so sorry. I didn't cast you off. Well, it can be a nuisance sometimes, but it doesn't stop me remembering how to open a locked gate or make the skipper a cup of tea.
We're going to be revisiting two canals that we know and love.
Oh, that's lovely. It's our canal, isn't it?
And two canals that are new to us.
We're at the summit!
Hooray!
It won't all be plain sailing.
Gosh, what's happened there?
We can't get through. It's blocked.
We'll be braving the great British summertime.
It's soaking.
And some of the most challenging routes on the network.
That is a bit scary.
And we'll be roping in our two boys, just like the old days.
We believe in making our crew work.
Canals reveal a hidden world.
Yes, little light at the end of the tunnel.
Each canal is different, but they all offer this wonderful antidote to the hurry and bustle of modern life. You can't rush on the canal. This week, we're going to explore a canal that's completely new to us.
It runs through a county where Prue and I both have strong connections.
Tim was born here whilst I was brought up in its glorious countryside.
By going up north to Yorkshire to the Rochdale Canal.
One of the great arteries of the Industrial Revolution. It was built to connect the once booming mill towns of West Yorkshire. Following a spectacular route, it wends its way through the steep-sided Calder Valley before climbing up to cross the Pennine Hills.
Climbing means more locks, and more locks, of course, means more work for the crew.
Yes, but you do it beautifully.
It's going to be very physically demanding, but at least for part of the way, we'll have some help from our eldest son, Sam.
As well as going over the Pennine Hills, we'll be taking a detour to go under them. As we enter the Stygian darkness of the longest and deepest canal tunnel in the country. Our journey begins near Halifax at Sorby Bridge, the original starting point for the canal.
Oh, here we are. It's a lovely wharf.
The canal was opened here over 200 years ago, and you can still see clear evidence of its industrial past. These warehouses would once have stored wool, corn, and machine tools that were unloaded off canal boats in the same covered dock that's still in use for maintenance today.
Whilst the cargo trade dried up over 80 years ago, fortunately for us, the new boat hire business is thriving.
We're going to sleep here, aren't we?
Bath.
Wow!
Please you.
I've never seen a bath on board before.
That's pretty
amazing.
Right. Rochdale Canal. It's very steep, the climb. Enormous number of locks. A lot of hard work. Right, Prue, cast off, please.
Right you are. Okay.
The Rochdale Canal was built to transport coal and textiles and link the mills and factories of West Yorkshire to the trading routes of the world. Built in the late 18th century, at the height of canal mania, it was the first canal route through the Pennine Hills. Like the commercial boats of old, our journey will take us past Mytholmroyd, the birthplace of the poet Ted Hughes, and the once mighty textile mills of Hebden Bridge and Todmorden, before climbing up into open moorland to our final destination, the canal's summit, an impressive 600 feet above sea level.
We've barely left the wharf before we face a series of dauntingly deep locks.
Have you thrown a rope?
I don't know whether I can get it up there. Oh.
20 years ago, this would have been easier for Prue. But these days, I have to keep a close eye on her.
Okay, brilliant, thank you.
So there are three locks together on this one, the third being the deepest lock in the UK.
And before I get a chance to catch my breath, we're in it. Tewell Lane Lock.
So deep, to fill it takes almost 200,000 gallons of water.
Should we do it this side?
Can't reach.
We might be seasoned narrow boaters, but I'm starting to feel quite vulnerable down here.
I keep being driven over.
Locks as deep as this one are dangerous places.
Right, I'm doing that.
Which is why the lock keepers are watching closely.
Pull all the rope through. That's it. Keep pulling.
I keep thinking about the enormous wall of water that's just behind that lock gate.
Letting the water rush in too fast could spell disaster.
Realise that this is going to be a very testing journey indeed.
Well, that was quite exciting, wasn't it, that deep block? But we managed it.
Well, it was unbelievable. Very, very, very hard work. I mean, I wouldn't like to do it every day, but I'm quite proud to have done it.
Thank goodness we've got a few miles free of locks to recover and enjoy the scenery.
I love the way it's in the countryside. It's almost under the countryside, you know.
It is lovely to be on this beautiful stretch of land, and one of the most wonderful things is being on our own, not passing miles and miles of moored boats.
A century ago, things were very different. Then the Calder Valley was at the beating heart of Britain's global textile industry, which at its height produced half the world's cotton. The Rochdale would have throbbed with traffic as broad and narrow beam boats ferried raw materials and finished goods to and from the mills that once lined the canal.
But the gradual decline of the industry and its eventual collapse brought hard times to the valley's once prosperous towns, and the canal itself became ever more dilapidated.
It was the boyhood memories of living beside the ailing canal back then that inspired one of this country's finest poets.
We're just about to reach the little village of Mytholmroyd, which is remembered as the birthplace of the poet Ted Hughes. And he wrote a lot about canals. And one or two of his most famous poems were born around here.
We're meeting local Ted Hughes expert, Nick Wilding.
Hello.
Hello.
What a beautiful day to visit Mytholmroyd.
In a poem, Ted vividly captures one of his childhood experiences on this canal. Nick knows the exact spot that he was writing about.
Right, so we'll have a look. In the 1930s, this was where young Teddy, because that's what they called him in those days, would come with his friends and play.
And fish.
Yeah. And in actual fact, this road here is the big main A646. Mm-hmm. And I think Ted often felt as a child that everybody was going somewhere else. Mytholmroyd was just a little place stuck away in the middle and people just missed it.
And went round it.
Yes. Let's have a listen to what he would have heard in those days.
Lorries from Bradford, baled with plump and towering wools and cotton, met above my head lorries from Rochdale, and ground past each other, making that cavern of air and water tremble. Suddenly a crash. The long, green, ponderous, watery echo shattered. And at last it had begun. That could only have been a brick from the ceiling. The bridge was starting to collapse. But the canal swallowed its scare. The heavy mirror re-glassed itself. And the black arch gazed up at the black arch. Beautiful, beautiful poem.
Lovely stuff.
It's wonderful when you think it's just been created out of that one little moment. Yes. And what's wonderful about it too is that there aren't that many children of 7 or 8 years old who, wherever they go, they make notes of everything they see and everything they do. And he did that. And then later in life, when he came back, he reacquainted himself with his roots here.
Like Ted Hughes, I too have roots in this county.
I was born in Yorkshire.
Only because his parents happened to be on tour there at the time.
My father was playing at the Prince's Theatre at the time. I think a month later, it would have been Eastbourne. And a month later than that, Blackburn, I believe. Anyway, so I am technically a Yorkshireman.
So he's not a genuine Yorkshireman. My family do come from Yorkshire, and I spent a lot of my childhood during the war with our aunt in Yorkshire.
Her family were well off, and they owned Broadfield's Mill in Huddersfield, which used to import fine wool and turn it into cloth.
I can remember going in and watching the weavers at work.
Well, that's how I learned to speak Yorkshire, as it were. They articulate because of the sound of the mills. You had to talk like that in order to be understood, because of the sound of the mills.
Prue might have vivid recollections of her Yorkshire childhood, but recently she's been having problems with her short-term memory.
I have slight Alzheimer's, like most people of 80. One, am I?
Yes.
Yes. Well, my long-term memory is brilliant for Shakespeare sonnets and things like that, you know. But I can't actually remember what I did with my handbag this morning, you know.
You do repeat things.
Oh, yes.
And you tell the same story four times in an evening, but that's all right.
Oh, poor old you. I don't know how you've stood it all these years.
I miss the old Prue. Her quick responses, her sharp mind. That's gone now. And I have to learn to accept that.
I think I'm less sympathetic than I should be.
Oh, no, never let him say it. Really, darling?
I think I am.
No, but you've been that ever since we were married, and I had an absolutely brilliant memory when we were married, and you still got irritated.
Yes, I remember.
It's good to make a joke of it, but we both realise that we have to treasure every moment together, and we know no better place to do that than on a narrowboat. We're aiming to reach the highest point on the Rochdale Canal.
Locking up 600 feet into the Pennines is already challenge enough, without the additional help of this typical British summer weather.
Opening the locks in this would be too slippery and dangerous for Prue. So we're going to have to postpone our journey on the Rochdale and instead explore an incredible feat of 18th century engineering on a neighbouring canal.
I thought today we'd go to the Huddersfield Narrow.
Oh, good, yes.
There's the Huddersfield Narrow, you see.
Yeah, right.
It goes through a long tunnel.
The
Stanage Tunnel, which is the other way of crossing the Pennines. It's a good place to be if it's going to continue raining.
The Pennines were the great obstacle for canal engineers as they divide England down the middle. The Rochdale engineer's solution was to go over the top, but on the Huddersfield Narrow, they decided to go through the middle, the result being the Standage Tunnel.
You must be Fred. Tim, Brunella, pleased to meet you.
Hello.
This is your boat. You'll be going into the tunnel shortly. I will be your chaperone.
Fred Carter has worked on the Huddersfield Narrow for the last 44 years and knows the hazards that we'll face once we're inside.
If you do wonder what the little machine that's around me at the moment is bleeping, it's sampling the atmosphere around us. If this alarms, we may need to stop the engine for a little while. Yeah. We may need to stop the boat for a little while.
How long is it exactly?
The tunnel is 3.25 miles. It is the longest, highest, deepest canal tunnel in this country.
And no towpath?
What the boat has had to do was to bring the boat through the tunnel by a method called legging. And two gentlemen would lay side by side, feet either side onto the side of the tunnel.
Even in a boat with an engine, we are not going to see the sky again for 3 hours. Sinister.
200 years ago, men carrying candles and wielding only picks and shovels hacked and blasted their way through 3.25 miles of solid rock.
And how long did it take them?
17 years. Originally, they said 6 years to build or complete the tunnel. Unfortunately, they hit this band of millstone grit. And it's one of the hardest rocks going.
The rock was so hard that in 1806, the chief engineer reported that they were sometimes digging through a mere 3 yards a week. Tunneling was a tough and extremely hazardous job, and many of the workers were killed through suffocation, floods, or rock falls.
How far are we from the surface here?
Your highest is about 680 feet.
Yeah. So there's quite a weight of material overhead.
Yeah, it's one of the few things we try not to think about.
The human cost of completing the tunnel was enormous. Hundreds were injured, and at least 50 men lost their lives down here.
I'm sorry we're bumping so much, it's
not a problem. The hardest thing on this job is the concentration, I'll tell you.
It's incredibly claustrophobic, and my mind keeps turning to all those men who died building this tunnel.
Steady now, steady.
It's as if we are journeying into the underworld. Oh, it's water. After an hour and a half down here, the cold and damp seem to penetrate my very soul.
You get to the stage where you think, is it really ever going to end? It makes me feel as if I've died, and it's the afterlife, and I don't know what's going to be at the end of the tunnel. I don't know whether I'm going to go to hell or come out into heaven, perhaps. There's no light at the end of the tunnel.
It's like a tiny little star. Well, I suppose that must be the longest time I've ever spent underground in my life.
There is another world. Cold and rainy.
3 hours underground in the gloom was emotionally draining. This trip is proving to be demanding in unexpected ways.
It's time for us to head back to the Rochdale Canal. We're only a quarter of the way through our journey to its summit, and there are still dozens of testing locks ahead. But at least it stopped raining.
These lock gates were designed to be opened by tough working men, not actresses of a certain age.
Excuse me, hello? Could you come and help me with this gate? It's too heavy for me. I think it's a two-person gate. Brilliant.
It's the first boat we've come across on this canal, and they couldn't have come at a better time.
Okay.
But there's no time to recover before I've got to tackle the next one. This gate is putting up a good fight. I need all my strength to open the lock. Finally, we're through. Next stop, Hebden Bridge.
In the great days of its textile industry, there were so many cloth mills in Hebden Bridge. It was known as Trouser Town. Now, I once played a character who, back then, would have felt very much at home here.
He was called Bradley Hardacre, and it was in this television series called Brass. It was a mill and mining boss. He liked things his own way, and liked to get his end away with the wife of one of his employees. I remember him coming into his wife's bedroom and she was having an argument about something, and Bradley said, I can't stand here all day chatting, I've got men to lay off.
Sadly, in real life, that's exactly what happened to the mill workers of Hebden Bridge when the textile industry collapsed.
It once boasted 18 mills and clothing factories, but by the late 1960s, most had closed down, forcing families to leave their homes to look for work elsewhere. Hebden Bridge became a virtual ghost town.
But in the early 1970s, painters, musicians and writers began to move into the abandoned mill workers' cottages, and the old working class town began to change.
Today, Hebden Bridge has become a centre for new age activists and alternative lifestyles. The days of making trousers are long gone. Now Hebden is all about the arts.
His eyes sharp as knives.
Be quiet!
He'll cut off my nose.
Tim and I have always actively supported regional theatres since our own time in Rep. So any visit to Hebden has to include a trip to their canal side playhouse.
You can't touch me! Do you understand? I'm here. You've been looked after. I won't go away. I'll make it all disappear. I'll get rid of him. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. How many more weeks
we've
for rehearsal?
We've got about four.
Oh,
and
brilliant.
Half.
Well, it's a very, very high standard, and the involvement and the concentration was excellent.
Are there any of you who have thoughts of being a professional?
Yeah, I'd love to. And I've been in a few different things around, like locally and things. And,
yes.
And I've done one professional thing as well, which taught me lots as well. But I was wondering, what advice do you have? How did you build up?
I went to the Old Vic Theatre School. Yeah. Most of it was dead now, but it was a wonderful training.
In my day, you'd cut your teeth on all sorts of different styles and different authors. Mm. It stood you in very good stead, whereas nowadays, people don't think versatility is terribly important, do they? If you, the best way to get on in television is to play exactly the same thing always. And be seen doing it regularly.
You're not talking about me, though, are you?
No, but...
So, you spent your life doing it, so did you make the right decision?
I hope so. It's a bit late to change my mind, isn't it?
Yeah. I think it's a treat to be able to go off in the morning looking forward to getting to work. You know, an awful lot of people don't, do they? So, lots of luck with the show, and very glad to have met you.
Thank you
very much. Best of luck with it.
Nurturing new talent is so important. Who knows when you might stumble across the next Prunella Scales?
Oh, shut up!
Today's Hebden Bridge is thronging with tourists, but it still has echoes of its industrial past. We're meeting a woman who runs horse-drawn canal trips, keeping a 200-year-old tradition alive.
Hi, lovely to see you. I'm Sue Day, and this is Bilbo Baggins.
Bilbo Baggins,
he's very down to earth, and he's got hairy feet, just as Bilbo Baggins in The Hobbit.
How long have you been
working him?
Well, it's only Bilbo's 6th year, but I started horse boating in 1980, and then I came onto this canal in 1987. Yes. I've got a little passenger boat here, carries only 12 people. There's only 4 horse-drawn passenger boats left in the whole of Britain now.
Yes, we know the one in Hungerford.
Yep.
Yes.
That's a wonderful one down on the Kent and Avon.
Yeah. Yes.
Horse-drawn narrowboats were the HGVs of the 18th and 19th centuries. Pulling 25 times as much as a cart, it was horsepower that drove Britain's first transport revolution.
It's got the longest under-eye lashes I've ever seen on a horse.
Rather pretty, aren't they, for a boy? But he gets rather annoyed when I call him pretty. Handsome, he says. Handsome.
You're handsome. Lovely boy. Goodbye, darling.
Goodbye. Just like a kiss.
We are at the halfway point on our journey to the summit of the Rochdale Canal, but the hardest and steepest stretch of it is still to come.
Luckily, the crew is about to be reinforced as our son Sam is joining us.
Look who it is. You want a boat with a glass of wine. Why am I not surprised?
Sam's a busy actor, so we don't see him nearly as much as we'd like.
Welcome. Permission to come aboard, sir.
Okay. But today, he is hot-footed it all the way from a performance in Jordan to help out his old mum and dad.
Nice, isn't it? Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Cheers.
Cheers.
When were we last on the canals together, the three of us?
I don't know, 15 years maybe.
It was brilliant, you and Joe in life jackets, you know.
I think so too.
Yes, and opening and shutting the locks. I hardly ever had to work a lock. We've only got Sam's help for one day. So, we better get going.
Chimneys are great, aren't they?
Almost everywhere we look is evidence of the Rochdale's industrial past.
What is it?
Well, I suppose it's the remains of an old mill. There were something like 19 clothing factories here in the 20s when the cotton business began to collapse and we began to import all our cotton and all our clothes from India.
Yes. You get an incredible feeling of the infrastructure that it must have been so hard to build and now has been turned over to leisure, but if it was entirely a leisure pursuit, none of this would exist and none of it would matter.
No, that's right.
This area has seen some tough times, but the canal's recent restoration has helped breathe new life into the whole valley.
Right, who's doing this lock?
You want to do it?
By wind. Okay, ready when you are.
Our sons were trained up over many family holidays, so Sam certainly knows how to operate a lock.
This is the first time I've ever locked up over the Pennines, because in the past our boats have been based either on the Oxford or the Kennet and Avon. I've never done any of these canals before. And as you would expect, it's pretty dramatic. It's the perfect mixture of the natural and the industrial, I think. There we are.
Okay. Tim might have taught him the art of narrow boating.
No, use this one. All right, I'm just taking the middle as well.
But as with all children, as he's got older, he's developed ideas of his own.
If I'm clever, I might be able to throw a loop. Nah! Sorry, what sort of a knot was that?
It's tied up. It's perfect. It didn't slip. We just got higher.
Well, it did because you haven't tied it off.
I did tie it off, but no,
it slipped.
No, it came. It went round once, but it was a round turn and 1/2 inch. It didn't slip. As you go up, the thing gets looser.
Yes, so therefore you can tie it up fairly tightly if you're going up.
Which I did. And as
we came up,
it went outwards. I'll show you at the next one if you want.
Old stag and young buck, it's always a problem, isn't it?
Oh dear, this journey is tough enough without family squabbles. We're going to have to pull together if we're going to make it to the summit.
We're attempting to reach the summit of the Rochdale Canal, 600 feet above sea level. For this crew of senior citizens, it's proving quite a challenge. Fortunately, we've had an injection of young blood in the form of our son, Samuel West.
but after wrestling with the Rochdale's heavy lock gates, even Sam is ready for a break.
This is Stubbing Wharf, and it might be nice to just call in and, it being quarter to 12, perhaps have a glass of wine?
Yeah, okay.
So we'll pull in here.
But we're here for more than just a drink. Some of the most poignant words ever written about this valley were inspired by a visit to this pub when Ted Hughes came here in 1959.
So why did he write about this place?
He was just in a very, very dismal frame of mind. Stubbing Wharf. Between the canal and the river, we sat in the gummy, dark bar. Winter night rain, the Black Hump Bridge and its cobbles sweating black under lamps of dazzling yellow.
The windows glittered black. If this was the glamour of an English pub, it was horrible, like a bubble in the sunk Titanic. Everything was there in my Guinness. Where exactly? That was the question.
That dark... In the late 1950s, the Calder Valley was in the grip of an economic depression. And for Ted and his wife, Sylvia Plath, the valley's dereliction echoed their own state of mind.
A gorge of ruined mills and abandoned chapels, the fouled nest of the Industrial Revolution that had flown.
But even gloomy Ted on that bleak winter's night saw a glimmer of hope.
I had to smile. You had to smile. The future seemed to ease open a fraction. Lovely stuff. Isn't that a brilliant ending?
Ted was right to be optimistic. The future has opened up for this canal. After being closed for 50 years, it was finally reopened in 2002. Leisure craft have replaced the old working boats, and the once derelict mills have been transformed into homes and offices. Once again, the Rochdale Canal is open for business.
That's rather a nice pub.
It's fine. It's in a lovely position.
Yeah, very well suited for the canal.
Yeah.
Very popular. You've deadheaded most of the plants outside, so they're doing well.
Yes, I had a go.
Time to head off again. Now Sam's a grown man, his dad kindly allows him to take a turn at being the captain.
There's the lock.
With Sam taking the helm, traditional roles are reversed. It's the parents who must do as they're told and open the locks.
Ooh, look out for the mud.
Yeah. Sam's a very good skipper. He's very good and he's very agile. He likes to do things his own way, so when it's his turn, just leave him to it.
We believe in making our crew work.
Give us a hand.
What? Okay. Ready?
Yeah.
You know, the nice thing about a canal holiday is that it's kind of relaxing, but it's also quite hard work. Right. Doing a big lock flight is proper tiring. It's teamwork, you know. If you've got a crew that's also a family, it's always easier.
And after our hard work, the canal gives us a reward, a lock-free section where we can take it easy, at least for a bit.
This is really slow travel. This is very relaxed. It is a brilliant way of seeing England slowly. The first day, you think, this is too slow. By the end of the week, you go back to London or wherever, and it's all rather bracing and a bit fast.
There's some lovely country here. It's a beautiful valley. And I think we'll just enjoy just tooling along, which is what you should do, really, in the canals. Not try and get anywhere special by any special time, because you usually don't.
For years, canals have been a place for our family to relax and spend time together.
Well, we've been very lucky. We had our first canal holiday in the great hot summer of 76. Over the years, It's been our favourite holiday. It's always been something that we've been able to do as a family, and although I remember, you know, terrible family arguments when I was 16, I can't imagine that they were any worse on the canals than they would have been anywhere else. And you can always go to one end of the boat and have 60 foot of peace between you. As my father's very fond of saying, you know, if anything goes wrong, you can always walk wherever you were going quicker.
Tim and Sam don't get enough time together, and after their spat earlier, I've sent them off. They can bond by the canal, and I get a bit of peace and quiet.
How's it going?
Yeah.
You never know, they might catch our supper.
Yeah. I've never really known about fishing. Sometimes on a Sunday morning, a pouring wet day, and you see a fisherman there with his rod, and he's got his hat on and he's waterproof, and he's stuck there in the rain. And I think, you know, what's his home life like? Well, this must be better. And so I've never really warmed to it, but I'm ready to be convinced.
It's just quiet, peace and quiet, being out in the countryside, seeing all the wildlife.
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen a kingfisher this morning. Yeah. Sometimes the kingfishers catch more fish than you do, you know.
Yeah. Oh, hello. Hey.
So what's that?
That's a roach, that. Would you like to have a go?
Absolutely.
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
That's ready for going now. Okay. So you just swing it like that.
Has he got a longer pole than I have?
He has, yes.
Oh, that's why I can't get it out.
Yes, I have got a longer pole. Well, some people have long poles and some don't, you know. It's just the way it is.
Remember the last time we did this?
Battersea Park.
Battersea Park, 1973 or so.
Was it?
And I seem to remember there's a photograph of me in a bobble hat and wellies.
Yeah.
Carrying a rod, and we went off to... I thought we were going to catch our dinner. And the first cast went into the tree. And in pulling it out, I broke the line. So we came home at about 2:30 in the afternoon.
Had baked beans.
And had baked beans, exactly.
I can see the appeal. I want a little reward at the end of the day, though, I think.
But just like our last fishing expedition 40 years ago, we head for home empty-handed.
It's a shame you didn't catch something.
How was the fishing?
Well, it depends from our point of view or the fish's point of view.
The fish came out ahead.
The fish came ahead a great time.
2-0 to the fish.
We have to make the most of these moments on board together. Sam has to head back to London soon, and you never know when the next time will be.
I shall miss you as crew.
It's much easier with two people doing the winding. Sorry about that.
Well, thanks so much for coming up.
Thank you.
Don't be silly. Lovely to be doing it again.
Yeah, it was.
Righto. Ta-ra.
Ta-ra.
See ya. Mm. Go after yourself.
And
safe journey.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. That was great.
See you soon.
Yes, please.
Yeah, yes, please. Go carefully.
Just us then.
Yeah, never mind.
Bye.
That's nice.
Yeah. More tea.
Thank you. When one's children have grown up, you'll have every opportunity of seeing something of them. His brother lives in France, so we see even less of him. But Sam being an actor, we do coincide from time to time, which is nice. Good.
With Sam gone, Prue and I have to fend for ourselves for the rest of the journey. We've still got to get through the old mill town of Todmorden before we reach open countryside and the steep loch-filled climb up into the Pennines and our final destination, the highest point on the canal.
It's not only the crew that's starting to feel the strain. Many of these lock gates are as old as the canal itself.
Poor old Prue's having quite a bad time there. I think we're finding one or two paddles not working at all, and some very, very stiff.
This doesn't bode well for our attempt on the summit of this canal. From here on in, the locks get more and more frequent.
This is going to take forever.
And then we hit an even more serious problem.
Oh, gosh. Well, what's happened over there? It looks like some scaffolding has fallen into the canal. Tim! Watch out for the scaffolding. excuse me, do you mind my getting ashore over your boat?
Not at all.
Thank you very much. Gosh, what's happened there? Is it all right to go use the lock?
There's some scaffolding has dropped from I don't know where into the canal and it's blocked. We can't get through.
Well, apparently there's been some sort of structural misfortune there and they won't let a boat go through.
It's closed because apparently it's been hit by someone. They raced off without stopping and they're being reported to the police. But that hasn't helped the bridge.
For health and safety reasons, this section of the canal is effectively closed.
The insurance won't cover anybody being under the bridge at all.
And at the moment, we have no way of reaching the summit and completing our journey. We're aiming to reach the highest point on the Rochdale Canal, but our journey has been halted because of a dangerously unstable bridge.
But luckily for us, the chaps from the Canal and River Trust have come up with a solution.
We can go through as long as the boat is pulled through, so that's where we'll have to carry on. But it's different. So that's held us back a bit, but that's the way it goes.
Right, time for the final push. I believe it's going to be very hard work.
Since we left Sorby Bridge, we've been slowly ascending for 11 miles. And as we near our destination, the landscape changes. The last of the industrial buildings fade away. It's just us and the unspoiled beauty of the Pennines.
Strange to see so little traffic. We haven't passed another boat today.
But this journey is far from over. Now it's shallow water that's holding us up.
All right, we're ground again. This is when the canal becomes your enemy. You get the feeling they just don't want you here.
These lock gates aren't making my job easier either. As we climb higher up towards the summit, the locks become ever more frequent.
Gosh, it's huge, isn't it?
There's swing bridges to deal with, too. If only Sam were still here to lend us a hand.
This journey has taken a lot out of us both.
Oh, sorry.
And we're both starting to make mistakes.
Cap!
My fault.
Sorry, I didn't cast you off. Oh, my darling, I'm so sorry. Crisis! This will be a big number.
Yeah, it's well jammed now.
Oh, fart.
In fact, this time we get away with it. Just a couple of broken glasses. And we limp on.
But perhaps salvation is at hand.
I've got some help here. Isn't it? They're running away.
No, they're finished now. Thank you.
Like our two sons once did, these children seem to thrive on the freedom canals offer.
I haven't got my crew anymore.
Tea break.
Yorkshire, Lancashire.
And Lancashire.
Oh, well.
Reaching the county border means we are virtually at the summit. And with the end in sight, there's no stopping Prue.
OK, go gently with the paddles. Yes, that's the last lock. There is the actual summit.
Sam? We're at the summit.
Hooray! Done it.
It's the hardest canal journey I've ever undertaken, but the view from up here makes it all seem worth it.
Well, we're at the top of the flight. We haven't done this flight before, and it's very exciting. Up here, it's absolute magic. I didn't know this part of the canal at all, and it's extraordinary, beautiful.
So here we are, 600 feet above sea level.
I believe that.
We've been on quite a journey. Not just a physical one of demanding locks and dramatic scenery, but a journey through time.
It's brought back memories of my own childhood in Yorkshire and of many happy holidays with Tim and the boys.
It's a canal that tells a story, doesn't it? I mean, you've seen how it developed, why it was necessary, how it flourished, how it died.
Down the years, this canal has touched the lives of so many people, and its restoration has helped transform the whole Calder Valley.
Ted Hughes once described it as a gorge of ruined mills and abandoned chapels. But look at it now.
Next week, we head for the Welsh Hills, cross the longest and highest aqueduct in the country.
That is a bit scary.
Explore forgotten corners of the network and battle the great British weather.
If you've been affected by issues in this programme, look for support links at channel4.com/support. And the Llangollen Great Canal journeys next Monday at 9. We're in Wokingham tomorrow with Amanda Lamb. The decking and the decor seem to be holding things back, selling houses at 9. And in a moment, we're dropping in on some of the families we met on the wards in Wombourne. That's next.